Welcome to Voices of Truth, one-on-one with Hawaii's future, brought to you by the Kauai Foundation. I'm Mahu Kekahu Cardwell, and here we are today on the island of Maui, and I'll tell you this right now, we have an amazing guest on the show, so let's go on over here and meet him. Bob, how are you?
Good. Aloha. Good day.
Aloha. Robert Wintner, did I say your name right?
You did well.
Wonderful. But people don't know you as Robert Wintner. They know you as Snorkel Bob, right?
Well, yeah.
And Snorkel Bob, who do we have with us here today?
This is Cookie.
Wow. So Cookie's going to be on the show with us. Hi, Cookie.
Face the camera, Cookie.
And we're standing in front of one of your stores here on Maui, yes?
That's right. We're at Wailea, South Maui. And this happens to be one of our art galleries as well. There are three in total.
Wow.
And they're quite nice.
So you sell art in here, but you also sell, or I guess, rent equipment for people that want to snorkel, want to get out on the ocean, in the ocean and have fun, yeah?
That's right. I think we put more people, more visitors in the ocean than anybody else in Hawaii.
Wow. Well, that as good and fun as that is, Snorkel Bob, that's not why we're here today. We wanted to talk to you about actually a serious topic, and that is what's going on in the ocean and what really should be going on in the ocean as it relates to the fish that swim in the ocean, the inhabitants of the ocean, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So tell us a little bit about that.
It's no surprise to anybody. These are challenging times. Mm-hmm. And with changing times, we must adapt. And so what's happened in tourism is a change in messaging. Hawaii is still a happy place for visitors. It's not so much the rah-rah, sis, boom, bah that it used to be. We have visitors now showing up at Snorkel Bob's with gratitude for the work that we do, for informing them, for telling the truth. Mm-hmm. I could gloss over the reef situation in Hawaii like many businesses do. It wouldn't be truthful, and truth is one of our products, and it wouldn't be productive. We love what we do. We love the product. We love the destination, which is reefs, Hawaii reefs. Mm-hmm. And they need help. They need our help.
Wow.
And that's what we're all about.
Excellent. Well, I know we're going to go inside your store and see about and learn about the reefs. Can we go inside right now?
Sure.
Wonderful. Let's do that. When you talk about the reefs, what you mean is the damage that's being done to the reefs. A lot of the reefs are dying today, yes?
That's correct.
And it doesn't stop there. It gets worse because a lot of the areas are being fished out specifically by the aquarium trades, yes?
That is correct.
Yeah. Yeah, so can you show us in your store here? This is really beautiful what you have. Can you tell us a little bit about that and show us some of the photographs you have here?
Well, as the song says, every picture tells a story. We can begin with surgeon fish schooling, and these are all herbivores. This is a hawksbill turtle in clear blue water, anemone clownfish. Mm-hmm. All of these creatures relate to reefs and pressures, oppression on those reefs in their own way.
So there's a reason that you have these specific fish displayed up here is because these are the ones that are in danger. They're the ones that are getting hit, yeah?
Yes and no. These are up here because these individual critters gave me these shots. There is no critter in the ocean that's not affected by aquarium trade extraction.
Really?
People around the world assume that somebody somewhere is growing these fish. 2% of all aquarium fish are captive bred. The rest are wild caught. They have another technique they use where they catch fry.
Little fish.
They're just barely hatched. Mm-hmm. The mortality is immense, and they catch them by the thousands, and they put them in tanks, and they call them tank rays. We have engaged the Hawaii State Legislature, and I always am careful to draw a distinction. I don't mean to get political, but sometimes it's unavoidable. I draw a distinction between Hawaii and the state of, because Hawaii had balances. It wasn't always perfect. There were a few mistakes, but there was a sense and a system of balance. The state of Hawaii does not have that sense. The state of Hawaii defers to commercial extraction. I could go on and on, Ehu, so please cut me off when you've heard quite enough, okay?
All right, so I want to say more about that distinction because that's an important one. When you say Hawaii versus the state, you mean Hawaii before it became the state.
I mean the host culture.
The old culture back in the old
days.
The
kapu system.
Yeah, they were very careful to keep the balance in nature around them.
Yes. In the mid-50s, the ocean was unlimited. Mm-hmm. You couldn't possibly ruin it. It's too big. You couldn't possibly catch all the fish or ruin the habitat. It's too big. Mm-hmm. And here we are. It's still mandated for optimal commercial extraction.
In the old days, there was balance in the Hawaiians' environment, and because their lives depended upon it. Today, that balance is gone, and it's all about money, the dollar, right?
Anywho, I'm not telling you anything. You know that's the case.
I know that, but some of our viewers may not know that. I like what you said earlier when you said, they let me take their picture.
It's a gift. Here's a good example. I don't know if you can get this. This is a yellowtail chorus, and this is Molokini. And these guys are gregarious. They're in your face, they're all over the place. They move, they're in the wrasse family and they move like wrasses. And you can't get them to hold still, you can't get a shot. And when that guy came up and gave me this, that's a gift. All I had to do was push the button, be ready. You get about a half a second to get the shot and you just have to be ready. There's many I didn't get. This is Cuba. Mm-hmm. This is Palau. This is right here on South Maui. We have a beautiful apex predator on our Hawaii reefs called an undulated eel. And most people don't know this, but when they go out and about for a cruise, which they do quite often, they get this chartreuse head bonnet and a houndstooth pattern on the body. When they come home into the burrow, they turn dark green. So I saw her out and about, just sitting on the bottom, which is pretty unusual, and I got a couple shots, and she looked up at me, and she scurried onto the burrow, and went all the way in, and then came back out to say, oh, hey, how you doing? And she didn't have time yet to change her color, and I got the shot. And these are cleaner shrimp, and there's a baby wrasse. This is the treasure of Hawaii. This is money and power right here, okay? Not what happens at the Capitol. And it's underwater, has been under the radar. They're taking it away, and it's got to stop. And that's, people tell me all the time, they're so grateful for my perseverance and diligence, and I say, that's not perseverance and diligence. I'm obsessive compulsive. I hate what's happening. I have no choice. This is not by choice. I get this, and I give back what I give. This is Indonesia.
Wow.
Komodo National Park. There's three sources of aquarium extraction right now in the Western Hemisphere. Hawaii is the third biggest. We have a fraction of the reef area of Komodo and the Philippines. This is Komodo, intense currents. It was a very challenging trip, but every now and then we come across gems like this. This is abundance. We hear this word sustainable. The aquarium trade has been crying for decades. It's sustainable, it's sustainable, and we've been pressing them, and we're pressing them hard now. What is the definition of sustainable? They can't define it. Abundance is the alternative of sustainable. My definition of sustainable, it's an acceptable level of destruction. Mm-hmm. This is abundance, and this is what Hawaii reefs can support. But oh no, they want to take it down to one or two or six brood pair and call it sustainable.
Well, Snorkel Bob, way back when before Hawaii became a state, this is what it used to look like in the water around Hawaii, yes?
It looked like this way past that. That was in 59. It looked like this up until 85.
Oh, no kidding.
Oh, yeah. And it's gone. This is right here, South Maui. This is about a half mile from here. This is a destination critter. This makes somebody's day to see this guy like this. And he's for sale online. It's not right. This is trafficking in wildlife for the pet trade.
You mean online? You can actually buy that fish,
fish
like that.
If I was not a photographer, but an aquarium collector, I wouldn't have gone, I'd have gone, shoo, and imagine this shot without the fish. That's what they leave behind.
Yeah.
And I get some criticism for using that phrase, trafficking in wildlife for the aquarium trade. There was a guy on PBS who said, no, that's wrong. Trafficking means illegal. I said, I don't think so. And I looked it up. Trafficking means illegal, illicit, and immoral. And that's what this is. This is Tahiti. This is a boxfish, a longhorn boxfish. We don't have this particular species of boxfish in Hawaii. In fact, we did have a lot of boxfish. Now we have no boxfish only on Maui. Maui County Council ran the aquarium trade off Maui County, out of Maui County, Maui, Molokai, and Lanai. But they even admit that, well, we caught all the box fish, but now they're coming back. This is another hawkfish, and I think this is Palau, but he just, all these fish are very cautious and circumspect, and when I approach, usually I'm not snorkeling. This guy was snorkeling and freediving, but this guy, I was on scuba, and you have to really control your bubbles because the bubbles can frighten them, and I do my old guy log, you know, flotsam impersonation, and they will open up and they engage. That's what I call a gift, and you get the shot, and it's art. This is Cuba, where we had, that was completely shark trip. We had probably 20 sharks on every dive. Interesting, in a nutshell, we have a great book on this, Reef Libre, an in-depth look at the last best reefs in the world and Cuban exceptionalism. One day, Fidel Castro, this was probably 30 years ago, said, no mas, no more taking sharks. And all the scientists said, no, if the sharks come back, the rest of the fish are going to get hammered, because look, they're sharks. And that was wrong. If you think about it, sharks are apex predators, top level. If the sharks are gone, the next two levels double. And the two below that disappear. And the two below that double. So short term, you lose half of your biodiversity. In 20 years, every reef should be able to support at least 20 sharks. In 20 years, they had that in Cuba, and now they have species that science itself thought were extinct. They have the three standards we have for reef health. They have 100% coral cover. All the biodiversity that was ever there is there again. And a 100% host of apex predators. It's mostly sharks, it's also big morays and groupers, Goliath groupers. Did you know that Goliath groupers were once abundant in Hawaii? And now there are zero fished out. How nice would it be to get them back? And then these are just smaller shots that are mostly artwork. Again, in Cuba, we ran into schools of tarpon. I don't fish for reasons that should be obvious. I really am close to these guys. These tarpon were dreamy, and you could just drift right on up to them and get the family portrait. This is free diving again in Tahiti, a little flounder coming off the bottom, and so on around.
Wow, I love the smile on this one, looking right at you and smiling.
That was Molokini here in South Maui, and I saw this parrot coming at me, and you know, when you have
parrotfish, yeah.
And when you have a camera, the camera case is about this big, and then the strobes go out like this. Well, if I lift my camera, it's intimidating. So I have to kind of turn away and lift it very closely and turn around. And I saw the parrotfish coming, and I waited till she was right there, giving me the big smile and ch-ch. And it's hard not to have a feeling that it's a gift.
A connection.
Yeah. We went for a dive on Lanai, and we ran into a school of raccoon butterfly fish, and one of the few butterflies that run in schools. And they kind of came close, and I raised my camera to take a shot, and they came even closer and got between my camera and me and surrounded me.
Now we've come down to the ocean, and a beautiful ocean it is here. Tell us where we are.
This is Ahihi Kinau. And Ahihi Kinau is a vast area. It begins just north of here by about a half a mile, and it goes south quite a way. And this is Ahihi Bay. And it's a very popular snorkel spot. We have a great turtle cleaning station, always active out here at about 40 feet. 2% of Hawaii near shore waters are protected from extraction.
2%?
2%.
That means 98% is not.
That's correct. Of the 2% that's protected, this is the highest classification in that group. This is MLCD, Marine Life Conservation District.
So there is fish out there still.
This is abundant.
Wow.
It's probably not like it used to be because you can't just protect a patch and not protect the rest and expect that patch to be what it was. But this is better than most places. The clarity and visibility here are great. And there are certain species, certain critters who live here. They know that they're protected.
In the summertime and around December holidays, I mean, there's a lot of tourism here, yeah?
Yes.
And they're in this water a lot.
Yes.
And so does that impact these fish at all?
I would say it's nothing impacts reef habitat and species like extraction, okay, especially commercial extraction. But the big effects right now on these fish, well, there are two of them. One is every place a tourist walks could be coral polyps. Our detractors like to say snorkelers are destroying reefs. Snorkelers aren't destroying reefs. Snorkelers can't touch reefs if it's deeper than 4 feet. The other thing that's a big issue, and we do have quite a bit of attention on this now, is the oxybenzoate sunscreen. It's far more toxic to coral polyps than anybody ever thought. It's not a new issue. It's getting media now like it's a new issue. It came up about 12 years ago. At that time, we stopped instantly selling sunscreen. We don't do it. We sell a full line of 100% UV shirts and hats. But that is an issue. It needs addressing. It's a no-brainer. It's obvious. If I were king, it would stop tomorrow all over Hawaii, just like it stopped on a dime at Snorkel Bob's.
Now, we've talked about the problems that are in Hawaii here with respect to this and the state of Hawaii versus old Hawaii. We've talked about Indonesia and the Philippines. But, I mean, it isn't just a problem, a serious problem for those areas. This is really a worldwide problem that affects the entire ecosystem, yes?
Yeah, there are very few problems right now affecting planet Earth that are local.
Yeah.
And especially when you talk about commercial extraction. There's very few commercial extractions that are small scale. If something is successful, it becomes an industry. And that's the long and the short of it. And I think that many, many people in the world who want to do the right thing, and it's more than seems apparent at some difficult times, want to make the change, want to see the change happen. We have to adapt. The whole thing where, you know, it's very nice that I recycle and that I, you know, do one thing and another, but those things aren't going to save reefs. And I think what you're also seeing is more people who become obsessive compulsive, and that alone won't get it. We need people not to commiserate. The time for another course of Kumbaya is over. It's time to step up and speak out. And then besides that, you gotta put some rubber on the road. You gotta make a difference. And sometimes the biggest challenge is figuring, well, how do I do that? How do you define that difference?
Yeah.
And if you can't define it, it's okay. The answer will come. Just keep working on it. And you can't ever give way to emotion. Believe me, it's rampant. I seethe and boil inside all the time. Often, if my thought bubble was visible, I'd get arrested. but you have to keep thinking. You have to remain calm, nuanced, effective. You got to keep, it's like the guy in Terminator. You got to read the situation, move with it. You know, you and I were talking about the effective lifespan of a CEO. It's 7 years. And I hit the wall at 15, something like that. By the way, Snorkel Bob's was 30 years in business last year.
Congratulations.
I had to reinvent myself. And this challenge, you know, the good thing is I view it as a contact sport. The biggest threat to conservationists is fatigue. It's emotional fatigue. I view this as a contact sport. It's important to take a break. It's important to keep things fresh. It's important to just really celebrate your victories and feel good about it. There is no ultimate victory. This challenge won't go away in our lifetime or from here on out.
So it's not like 10 years from now, you know, you will have won the game and you can knock it off and lay against a palm tree and drink a beer.
You can do that. It's important to do that along the way. Let me put it this way, and here's an announcement for my friends, and I say that facetiously, they're not my friends, in the aquarium trade. Our objective with the Hawaii aquarium trade is to end it, make it gone.
You mean so nobody will have aquariums in their homes?
So no reef wildlife will be taken from Hawaii reefs for the trade, okay? And then what? Do I sit on a palm tree and drink a beer? Yeah, probably two or three. But also, then we begin the next phase. What would happen if you tried to bring a duffel bag of heroin into the Honolulu airport?
They would catch you and seize it, and seize you.
Okay. Once we make reef wildlife contraband the same as wild birds or orangutans or alligators from anywhere else in the world, or pythons or lionfish, if they fly into the Honolulu airport from Indonesia or the Philippines, it will be contraband. That's our next challenge. So, you know, there's no ultimate victory. There's always the next game.
Yeah.
You win the Super Bowl, then there's next season.
Gotcha.
That's the way it is for conservationists. You got to enjoy it. You got to figure out how to have fun with it and make it a challenge. And that's conservation work.
Okay, Snorkel Bob, I know, you know, a lot of people watch Voices of Truth one-on-one with Hawaii's Future. And I'm sure a lot of those people, like me, have aquariums in our own homes. And a lot of those aquariums are not freshwater, but they're saltwater. So for those of us who have aquariums and do love to have fish inside of our residences, what tips can you give us so that when we go to the store and buy a fish, we can look out for, or questions we can ask, or not to buy something? Give us some direction here.
That's a very tough question. You know, I said earlier, I don't eat fish for obvious reasons. I don't have an aquarium for obvious reasons. It's, if you like to have fish, go in the water. I've heard people say, well, not everybody can get in the water. Okay, get a flat screen TV and a reef loop. It's live action, reef cam. There's no reason to have fish. Sometimes I think it's okay to have goldfish, but you know, if you can manage it, I'd say what I would recommend you do is to try to build a glass box, proportionate. So for you, it would be about 8 feet by 6 feet by 6 feet, and stay in there for a week. That's
and
what
see
you
how
should.
I like it. Yeah,
that's what you should do.
Those people that have saltwater aquariums, would it be better for them to convert to freshwater? Because they can then raise their own fish in that, like guppies and, you know, swordtail fish and, you know, things
like
that.
Yeah, it's better. It's a marginal difference. Remember, I told you that 98% of saltwater aquarium fish are wild caught.
Yes.
And 2% are captive bred.
Yes.
Those stats get inverted for freshwater.
Okay.
2% are wild caught. 98% are captive bred. So yeah, it's better. I think it's probably evident that I live this, and so for me, an aquarium does not compute. I love my dog.
Well, this is your aquarium.
This is my aquarium. Yeah. I don't even use the word aquarium. This is not my aquarium.
Yeah.
This is my ocean.
This is your neighborhood.
This is my neighborhood.
Yeah.
I love my dog, and I could put her in a spot that she loved, and she'd have a great time there. But if I stuck a stake in the ground and put her on a short rope, the love goes away.
Yeah.
That's what happens.
For those people that don't have aquariums in their homes, but go out around the world, wherever they are, and do snorkeling, they do scuba diving, things like that, what tips would you have, what do's and don'ts would you have for them?
I'm one of those people, and it's often the luck of the draw. I would just say, do your homework, find out who's got good reefs. Again, I'll explain, or I'll answer with an illustration. In the Free Republic of Palau, which is way south, it's below the equator, they had a remarkable dive and snorkel industry. And they figured that this was years ago, so these numbers are dated. They figured the average tourist spent $1,000 a day, which is pretty good. It's probably now $2,000 or $3,000 on, you know, hotel meals and recreation. And many of the dives they have these walls. We talked about 100% coral cover. In Palau, it's 600%. You have the inverts, the encrusteds and the inverts and the ascidians and the sea squirt, all that. And it just festooned along these walls. And one day, there was a Palauan, one guy, who had recruited a vessel from Korea or Taiwan to come down with a bunch of divers, and they went on one of these walls and they started catching reef fish. And the divers were watching them, and these guys were tearing it up. And there was so much, they'd never ruin it, never catch it all. We heard that before. And it was a huge problem. And word went out on the coconut wireless around the world, Palau is gone, they're there. And there was a guy, this was 2008, Tommy Remengasau Jr. was president of Palau, and he said, how do I handle this? And there was a banking bill at that time, so the banks could charge more for the money they loaned and pay less for the money they borrowed. And he put a line at the bottom. He had line item privileges, he said, and the aquarium trade shall be banned forever. Because there was only one Palauan involved. And the banker said, well, money and power, banks, yeah, pass it. Mm-hmm. And it's gone.
Wow.
He was president from 2008 to 2012. He's president again. And he's also, the United Nations recognized him as a global ambassador for the environment.
Wow.
And he's also my Facebook friend. And just a humble, down-to-earth, great guy who got the picture and shoo, one stroke, fixed the problem. I wish we had that kind of political will in Hawaii.
Mm. You know what? If you keep doing what you're doing, that'll happen.
Here's hoping.
That'll happen. What a great message. Snorkel Bob, mahalo to you for being on Voices of Truth and giving us the tour of your store, one of your stores on Maui. I know you have a whole bunch of them, and bringing us here and showing us your backyard.
Yeah.
And your friends that are in there.
This is the neighborhood.
And mahalo to you, our viewers, for joining Snorkel Bob and me right here. Remember, you can watch us on the web 24/7 on voicesoftruthtv.com, and you can like and visit Voices of Truth one-on-one with Hawaii's Future on Facebook. I'm Ehuke Kahu Cardwell for the Kauai Foundation, along with Snorkel Bob right here. And until next time, ahui ho! Mahalo for watching Voices of Truth one-on-one with Hawaii's Future. Watch us on the web 24/7 at voicesoftruthtv.com. You'll find all our shows, including this one, in case you want to see it again or share it with family and friends. Also, view our weekly video commentaries at freehawaiitv.com. And check out our blog, published daily, at freehawaii.info. It's all part of the Free Hawaii Broadcasting Network.